Reality. I'm Professor Borrowdale. And to start out with, we're going to have an announcement about the new philosophy club at Lane, the Titan Philosophy Club. So we have Dan Good, who's spearheading the effort, going to talk to us a little bit about that and his the Senate position he's running for.
Well, hello, everybody. My name is Dan, and I am currently acting president for the newly formed Titan Disc Golf, that's my other club, Philosophy Club. And right now, we are in the very beginning stages of bringing this club to fruition. We will be having our first meeting of the term be tomorrow, Friday, the 20th, from 3 to 5 up in the center building, room 202. It is right next to the Center for Student Engagement, where you smell the lovely scent of popcorn every day when you walk by. This meeting tomorrow will be for us to kind of start to develop what we actually want out of this club. There are many different aspects of what we want to do. We want to try and be able to, as a group, collectively come up with our game plans. Things that we're thinking about doing do involve taking some of the texts that we read and sitting down and having a discussion format about based on what we're learning. Just general conversation as well, any thoughts or ideas that we have as philosophers, bringing that format together. There is also conversation about documentary viewing with large class discussion, making it more of a school-wide event type of thing. So if anybody is interested, please come by tomorrow, be tomorrow afternoon, 3 p.m., going till 5, but you're not negated to actually stay there until 5. But that's about the time that we figure we're not rushing anything, but also long enough to really get into some in-depth conversations if we need to. At that point, once we're in the meeting, I can help get anybody who's not involved in it yet signed up on OrgSync, which is the campus organization website. It's kind of like a social media page for all the clubs on campus. So again, come and see us tomorrow at 3 o'clock, and hope to hear some great voices and thoughts coming from everybody here. The other reason that I'm here as well, I am currently running for one of the open seats on the Student Government Senate. There have been quite a few gaps going on recently, and it is showing a lack of voice from us as students to the administration. So myself wants to really bring in more of an ethical side to student life. I feel that we are not necessarily being heard, nor are we actually being paid attention to with the struggles that we as students deal with on a day-to-day basis. So I am here right now currently, hoping to get signatures. They call them signatures, but it's really just your printed name very legibly with your L number. If anybody's interested, I can send this around. As soon as I can get enough student votes to actually go and run for the Senate, then I have a quicker chance of actually getting in and starting to affect the policies that will in turn affect all of us here on campus. So I'll just go ahead and send this around if you'd like. Again, that's just print your name legibly with your L number. I think that's about all for me. If there's any questions that you have for me regarding either of those, I'm definitely open.
Thank you very much. All right. So tomorrow, 3 to 5, Center 202, the first, I suppose, you know, big first meeting of the Philosophy Club this term. Turn this thing off. Yes. There we go. Avoid feedback. Maybe I didn't. all right. Back to where we were last time. I don't know if I put a link to the I'll put a link to the PowerPoints up. I don't think I've got those up yet. I might have a PDF version up there or something of one of them. But I'll post a link in Moodle. And I'll send out a link to OrgSync too, the student organization group as well, so you can find it there. Oh, one more. I'll move this stuff into our current thing. Oh. Sorry about that. Let me see if I can. Oh, that's 205. No wonder. 203. There we go. So last time we were talking about the mind-body problem. And the question, it kind of comes there's sort of two things you're talking about. One is just generally the question about if there are these two fundamental stuffs in the universe, if we have matter and consciousness, or the physical world and the spiritual world, how do they interact? And then the other question is, if it's all material stuff, why does it seem that consciousness is different? And if it's all spiritual stuff, why does it really seem like there is a material world? So you have different problems. So if the mind and body are the same, why do they seem different? And if they're different, how do they interact? And in particular, think about the human being. So you think you have a mind, and you think you have a body, and intuitively, they seem like different substances. And so we talked about Descartes' idea, this idea of that there are these two substances. He's a dualist. He thinks there's both matter and spirit, and he thinks that they interact someplace mysteriously in the pineal gland. And then we just got to these parallelism, occasionalism, and epiphenomenalism. And I think I'm going to call it my starboard here, actually, for a moment to talk about these. So. There we go. So epiphenomenalism, it's kind of a long name. You can break it out. Epi means on top of, and then the word phenomenal. So you think about phenomena. Phenomenalism. And the idea is that the interaction between mind and body is a one-way interaction. So you have the body, and you have the mind. And the idea is that the body creates or causes the mind, or creates mental phenomena. But mental phenomena doesn't do anything. So again, the analogies we talked about in class, like you have a gas tank, and it's got a certain level of gas. And then you got some sort of little, like a little bobble here or something like that, however they work now. That's not very good. And some wires, right? And then it goes up to your gas gauge. And maybe it's reading, you know, empty or something like that. And what I was saying in class is that you can't take this needle and push it up towards the full sign and have any effect on your gas tank, right? So, and this is because this is one-way interaction. This is just, where this needle is just a result of the actual physical level of gas in your tank. And the same way, they would say there are certain things going on in your brain, the firings and the wirings of your neurons in your brain, and that creates consciousness. But consciousness isn't really a thing, but it's different than the physical world. So the idea is that consciousness is a different property. Sometimes people talk about it being like an emergent property. So this might be an emergent property. And sometimes this is also called weak dualism, because consciousness is not an independent substance. Another analogy, you have, you know, fire. And then you have smoke. So the fire causes the smoke, sort of smoke, you know, just smoke cloud, right? And it's, again, it's a one-way interaction thing. So what does the smoke do? Well, the smoke just sort of sits there and kind of floats around, right? And the idea is that consciousness kind of floats around your brain. It's not the same as your brain, it's different, but it's created by the brain, by the physical, chemical stuff that's going in your brain. But it's not a substance. So the idea is when you die and your brain, turns to mush, and unless you get, cryonically frozen, when your brain turns to mush, there's no more you. So this sort of cloud of smoke kind of dissipates. Aristotle had this, I think it's actually in Plato. There's one of the guys in the dialogue talking about this problem. I think it's Simmias. And Simmias says that, well, maybe it's sort of like music, right? So you have music is created by an instrument. So if you think about like the body being sort of like a musical instrument that's playing like a violin, right? You're playing and you make the music. And then you take the violin, you bash it on the ground like you're a rock musician or something like that. Well, that musician, the violin's not going to make any more sound, right? So it's that, where did the music go? Well, the idea is that as long as there's a violin playing, there's going to be music. It's caused by the vibrations of the string. The music isn't the same as the violin. It's created by the violin. But once you irreparably destroy the violin, there's no more music. So that's the sort of analogy. Maybe one more, like think about like a car, right? So you turn the ignition and the engine runs, and it runs on the gasoline, it burns gasoline, and that is combustion, it drives the pistons up and down and makes your car run. So that's a physical process. Your car is running. If you turn the car off, where did the running go? The running of your car? Well, it just, it's dormant, right? You might think about that being going to sleep, right? You go to sleep, consciousness ceases. Maybe there's some dreams when you're in REM state. When you're not in REM state, you're not really aware of anything. There's nothing going on in your mind, but your brain's still there, right? So, and when you wake up, your brain starts doing its thing again and consciousness returns. But if, you get... if your brain gets damaged, if you're riding your motorcycle without a helmet and go into a take a spill and go flying into a tree head first, you're going to be a great donor for some poor guy that needs a new liver or maybe a heart or some lungs, right? So you fly off your donor cycle and into the tree and your brain's pretty much done and there's no more consciousness for you. That's because your brain's destroyed. And it's not as if this consciousness can sort of floats up to heaven or hangs around as a ghost. So that the epiphenomenalism view says there is no immaterial spirit that survives the death of the body, but consciousness is still, it's a different thing than your physical body. So it's kind of like weak dualism is kind of like a middle position of people that don't want to go whole hog materialism because it seems like, yeah, mind and body, they are different. But they also don't want to have this sort of ghostly mini-me that's the real me hiding inside my body that's kind of controlling it like a robot, which is more like Descartes' view. And so they don't like the strong dualism. They don't like the materialism. So they kind of try to split the difference, and it's kind of a middle view. Any questions or comments about this? What do you think? Is this a good solution to the mind-body problem? Does it have the best of both worlds, the worst of both worlds? What, any thoughts on that? And speak loudly, please, if you wish to contribute. On epiphenomenalism. Just remember, epi is sort of on top of, right? So you think about consciousness sort of floating on top of. So it's that there's the body physically affects the mind or creates the mind, but the mind doesn't have any effect on the body. What about those mind-body interactions we were talking about last time? Like, you have an idea and it affects your body. What's the epiphenomenalist going to say about that? I was just talking about iced tea. I like it. Yeah, iced tea's got this hot wife, Coco Austin. I was in Vegas for a libertarian con and went to see, she did this, Las Vegas show, kind of sexy, right? you know, if I'm watching that, if I'm getting turned on, as you you're seeing this Vegas show with all these scantily clad girls, that's like I'm just having visual sensations, right? So I think what's the epiphenomenal going to say? I have like there's sort of ideas or stimulation, and then it causes physiological reaction. Well, is that now what are they going to say about that? It seems like they would have to say, well, I'm having visual sensations, and that's controlling, it's doing things to my brain that's causing that reaction. And my mind's sort of like a middleman. That seems kind of weird, though, right? Or let's take another example, like you're watching, I don't know, you go to see Hidden Figures, this story about the secret history of black women in the space program. And you're looking at this and you're like, oh, this is the unsung story of these heroic women who are pioneering the civil rights movement. And maybe you get a little emotional at the end, a little tear wells up, right? And is that, it seems like that's more of a mental thing or emotional thing. It seems like your mind is doing that, right? Your mind will cause physiological reactions. So what, can you think of what the epiphenomenalist might say about that? Any thoughts? Yeah.
Would they just say that the like outside stimuli would, like you process it with like your actual brain and then that produces what, you know, your conscious
brain
come from there?
Yeah, I think they'd have to say like your mind is doing this thing and your brain is doing this thing, your mind's kind of going along for the ride. But then it makes it seem like your mind is just your brain. It sounds good at first, but when you kind of dig deep and you think, well, what's going on when it seems like my mind's causing things to happen in my body? Is that just my brain? And it seems like this is really a case of my mind doing something. And when you say, oh, it's just the brain, it seems like you'd say that for anything. And maybe you think that the mind is the brain. So maybe you want to go to the mind-brain identity theory if you keep on saying, oh, that's just the brain, with things that clearly seem to have this mental thing that goes along with it. So this is one of the historic answers and one of those things that kind of seems good at first, but maybe not so great if you kind of pick it apart, as often is the case with these arguments. Now, a view which seems just, you know, horrible from the start, is this parallelism or occasionalism? Oh, what's that?
I said this one was really weird.
This one is weird, right? Parallelism.
Immediately didn't like it.
Oops, para. And what was it about that you thought was this kind of unpalatable?
Well, they're pretty much saying that, you know, your body and your mind never interact, but they're sort of like coinciding with one another, I guess. I don't know.
Is that right?
Yeah, no, I thought that it was like mind blowing. I stopped and I thought for a minute, and I just realized that it's something I never ever thought even possible before. And I thought it was a really kind of mind blowing what if.
Yeah.
I think it's true, but what if?
Yeah, so you get the mental and physical. And the idea is they just, you know, I suppose we just think about these being arrows. They go back and forth. And the idea that this doesn't happen and this doesn't happen. It's just there's no physical causing mental. There's no mental causing physical. It's just that at the beginning of time, God saw that I would want to go like this. Except for this camera's not showing me. I want to raise my hand in a opening gesture to emphasize a point, right? I want to, you know, gesticulate into the air, right? And so he arranged it so that all the causes from the beginning of time, from the Big Bang up to this moment of time, history of the Earth, so that my arm would go up in the air just like this to exactly match my intention. Because he knew what my intention was going to be, and so he sets up the physical world so that they sync up perfectly. So, you know, like this, just in the same way that you have the movie soundtrack and the movie picture, they're synced up, but they're completely separate processes. And when the actor, you look at the actor and his mouth is moving on the screen, that's not being caused by the stuff that's coming out of the speaker. They're both recorded separately, and they're both played back separately in different systems. But they're synced up in the right way, or so that your experience is the same as if someone were talking to you face-to-face. And in that case, you see the person's lips moving, and their mouth is actually making those sounds. On the camera, the person, originally their mouth was making that sound, but then it goes into the boom mic or the lapel mic, and then the picture gets recorded on the film, and then it gets put together, and it looks like as if you're talking face-to-face with that person, but it's not. They're just synced up perfectly. And sometimes, and if you've been in a movie where they get off, or if you see like people try to dub a foreign movie and they're not very good at it, and you know some guy says your kung fu is not very good, right? And you see the mouth keeps on moving and it doesn't really match up, or you know you're watching an action movie and Mel Gibson says you're all a bunch of melon farmers or something like that, and you're like, oh, I bet he said another word, and it didn't really match up, but it kind of matched up. They do these overdubs for, you know, when they put stuff on TV. Sometimes they're really funny. So why would you come up with a view like this? And what's the motivation?
Church.
I suppose church or church might fit into it, or religion might fit into it. So this is from this guy, Leibniz, is the guy that came up with it. Now, in the text I talk about Leibniz. Leibniz should be smarter than this. Leibniz invented calculus. I don't know if any of you have tried calculus or in calculus. He's a really smart guy. And he came up with a really stupid view. So I think it's important to ask why. Yeah.
Maybe to psych people out, but I was thinking maybe it's similar to I've heard people talk about before, that the movement of atoms kind of has everything pre-programmed,
mm-hmm.
and all, like every electrical synapses that goes through our brain is kind of powered by the movement of atoms, which is generating all the energy in the universe. And I was thinking in a way that might kind of tie into this, that every kind of thought and action we have is kind of pre-programmed, just a part of the happenings of the universe.
It does fit in with a kind of fatalism. Leibniz actually said he believes in free will, but it's a sort of funny kind of version of free will. It's compatible with determinism. This is kind of, to ask, like, what's wrong with it? It seems like it's consistent with the evidence, but it doesn't really fit because it's kind of, what's the word? I use this term, it's like a Rube Goldberg type thing. Have you ever seen like a Rube Goldberg machine? It has like a little ball rolls down a slide and it lands in a cup, and then the cup is like a teeter-totter and when this one thing goes down, the other thing goes up, and it shoots a ball into a hoop, and it goes to the hoop and then rolls down another thing. And there's all these things happening to these other things, and then all the at the end, like a mouse trap goes down, like a basket goes over a mouse or something. And Rube Goldberg did these illustrations, I think, of these sort of crazy contraptions that do a really simple thing. So the idea is you get a really complicated process that is a really simple thing. And in this case, it seems like this is a really complicated theory to explain something that's a simple thing. That's the interaction between mind and body. And to try to take huge pains to avoid that happening. So the idea is that it's so terrible to think about mind and body interacting, of fundamentally different substances causally affecting one another, that Leibniz will come up with anything to try to explain that. So what's the best he can do? Well, God sort of synced up these two things so that it looks like they interact, but really they don't. And so his motivation is, I think, really about the mind-body problem being a real problem. And seeing this as a huge problem that, you know, all these philosophers are writing about. They're trying to figure out, well, how is this supposed to work? And, you know, Descartes' version, I suppose, you know, maybe isn't that much better. He's like, well, it's kind of mysterious, like gravity. We don't really know how it works, but we know that it works. And I think it happens in the pineal gland, right? It's a little better, but he's also trying to figure out, like, why is it, or how is it that these two fundamentally different substances could affect one another. You think about, like, you know, like that movie Ghost with Patrick Swayze. This is an old movie now, and Whoopi Goldberg's in it. Demi Moore is there. She's, you know, making a pod on the pottery wheel, and then Patrick Swayze's character comes back as a ghost, and he tries to, like, you know, he tries to touch her or hug her, and his hands go whoop, right through because he's a ghost. And so the idea is that anytime a spirit wants to affect matter, how is that supposed to work? How does an intention create a physical effect? How is it that I want to move my hand and my hand moves? How is that supposed to work? Because they're fundamentally different substances. How do they affect one another? And so Leibniz is trying to deal with this, and he just essentially says, well, they don't. It just looks that way. I don't know anybody that actually believes this other than Leibniz. I don't know that anybody in the history of philosophy actually said, that seems like a really good view. I think I'll believe that. That seems like the best solution. And I think this is a great example of how, I'll just take as a quote from Thomas Sowell, some ideas are so absurd, only an intellectual could believe them. Or, you know, Bardell paraphrase, sometimes really smart people come up with really stupid ideas. And I'll say this is kind of a stupid idea. But I think in philosophy, a lot of times, seeing why people believe certain things, even though they look like they're wrong, sometimes they can be instructively wrong. And it can tell you, say, well, why would this person come up with this idea? It's because he sees this is such a big problem that this seems like the only way around it. There's no way to sort of to try to deal with it, and so you try to define the problem out of existence. Any other thoughts on parallelism, also known as occasionalism, because of the idea? Yeah, Leibniz said, on the occasion that I intend to move my arm moves. So it's occasionalism is another term for this. Oops. This is kind of a historical curiosity and part of the history of philosophy. Yeah.
So then would that mean that God synced up all the horrible things as well? Like,
yeah.
Prayer, so he's just kind of a...
So this is, you know, a big thing for, like, defense of the problem of evil, which is how could an omnipotent, benevolent God allow all the suffering we see in the world? And how could evil exist with a good God who's also all-powerful? And because it seems like if he's all-powerful, he'd be able to prevent evil. If he's all-good, then he'd want to prevent evil. But it seems like there's evil. And so one traditional defense is the free will defense. And it seems like that kind of goes out the window with this view, because it's kind of a deterministic view. Maybe it's not, you still, even with the free will defense, you have to explain, like, why does God allow evil? And it seems like there's some things that don't have to do with human free will that are still really bad and cause people to suffer, like earthquakes and volcanoes. And so, I mean, you still have that problem. Maybe it's not as bad. It seems like here God sort of designs things and has to program in all the bad things that happen to people. And that seems like especially bad for the problem of evil. And Leibniz actually talks about this in his philosophy. He's lampooned in the novel Candide by Voltaire. And in one of the scenes, they're at the catastrophic Lisbon earthquake in Lisbon, Portugal. And, you know, a lot of people died. And so they're on a ship, and so they're observing this thing. And there's this philosopher, Pangloss, who's a thinly veiled caricature of Leibniz. And he says, "'Tis the best of all possible worlds." And this is one of the ideas Leibniz had, was that the world that we live in, because God is good and he's perfect, the world we live in must be the best logically possible world, because that's the only kind of world that God would create. And so you have Pangloss, this philosopher, watching this catastrophic occurrence and all this suffering and death, and he says, it is the best of all possible worlds. And I think the next line is a sailor says, bloody hell, let's go in and loot the city. So like on top of the natural evil of the earthquake, you have the people that go in and, you know, take advantage and loot. And there's Pangloss in his weird philosopher's bubble saying, this is not only as good as it gets, but this is as good as it could possibly be. Anyway, that's actually something we'll get into later on when we talk about arguments for God's existence. But you know, Leibniz, he's an inventor of calculus, or discoverer of calculus. I shouldn't say invention, but he was one of the people that discovered the calculus, and he discovered it in Germany, and then Newton discovered it in Britain, and each accused the other of stealing their discovery. But it seems like they both came up with it on their own, because given historical circumstances and humanity's sort of progress at the time, the intellectual climate, it seems like they both came up with it spontaneously, but both, you know, fought for credit over it. Okay. Smart guy, dumb view. Let's get to the materialist answers. So the two dualist answers, the mind-body problem. So if there are two fundamentally different substances, how do they interact? And so we had, we had three. We had Cartesian interactionism. Oops. So that was the first one, that they interact. They do interact, and we don't really know how, and it happens in the pineal gland. And then these two, epiphenomenalism says, well, they don't... There's a causal relationship, but it's it's body to mind, not mind to body, that the body creates consciousness as sort of a byproduct of the mechanical workings of the brain, the electrochemical stuff, and that consciousness is just sort of a phenomena that's separate from the physical workings of the brain, but doesn't really have any causal power. And then parallelism and occasionalism would just tries to avoid the problem completely by saying there's no interaction at all. It just looks like that because of the way God synced up two parallel processes. Okay, so another solution to the mind-body problem, eliminative or reductive materialism, and then there's another one just called materialism or simple materialism. So I'm going to talk a minute about eliminative or reductive materialism. So the materialists just say there's no such thing as, well, the materialists in general say there's no such thing as spiritual substance, that all there is atoms in the void, that consciousness isn't a substance, it's just, then the question is, what is it? Why do people use mentalistic language? Why do people talk about thoughts and feelings instead of brain states? Why do people talk about ideas? And why do ideas seem different than objects? And so the eliminative or reductive materialist will say it's because people use this sort of mentalistic language, and it's a throwback to a more primitive time when people believed in souls, they believed in spirits and gods. And now we realize that's a bunch of superstitious nonsense, and there are no such things. But people still use the same language. And so the idea is that what we need to do is get away from that, particularly when we're acting as philosophers or as scientists. We want to avoid such talk. And so the language of the mind is what they call folk psychology. So folk psychology is basically kind of like everyday talk about the mind. So if you say, hey, I have a great idea, or if you say, Mary is feeling sad, or if you say, Al is angry, Bill is late for the bus. I see him running over there towards the bus. So that's all folk psychology. It's descriptions of people's intentions, of their feelings, emotions, and And you're talking about what you think is going on inside their mind, the kind of interior mental life of your friends. Or you might be descriptive of yourself, talking about how you feel or what you think. And the idea is that all of this is, it's kind of a throwback to this belief in consciousness as a separate substance. And it's about how we, you know, talk about these things. And that the eliminative or reductive materialist will say, there are no thoughts, there are no feelings. There's just firings and wirings of your brain. There's a complex firing of neurons. And so the idea we have, oh, I got this here. So talk about thoughts, feelings, beliefs, intentions. And the idea is this is all scientific or misleading. So what they would say was, if you're going to write a book of philosophy or a journal article, or if you're going to publish something in a scientific periodical, don't mention any of that stuff, because it's just going to confuse people. So let's see. So what their idea is that you should be very careful to restrict yourself to precise quantifiable terms and observations. So what they say is, okay, there's no such thing as spirit or mind, and we should just junk those terms altogether. And maybe when you're hanging out with your friends, you can, you know, talk out or however you want. But if you're going to be, if you're involved in intellectual discourse, you're in an academic setting, you're doing research, you're writing a book, even a book of psychology, you want to talk about people's feelings in a book of psychology. You should be talking about their brain. Or you should talk about behavior, like what did this, you know, what did these people do in this experiment. And you always need to quantify things. So you want to make sure that you can measure things and give everything a number. So you don't want to talk about people being, you know, depressed. You want to talk about, you know, depressive behavior, which has all these different markers. And you might talk about, I think of other things, people's reactions. You want to measure them with the various kinds of devices, electrodes in their brain. You want to do brain scans. And even when you're describing a person's behavior, you want to avoid guesses about what's going on inside their mind, because there is no such thing as their mind. It's just their brain. So that's the basic idea. It's the idea of getting super science-y about how you describe mental things, because there are no mental things. So imagine, like, if you turn on the weather report and the meteorologist, you know, has some, like, map behind him, and he says, well, folks, looks like Zeus is angry. Thunderstorms on their way, right? You think, Zeus is angry. Oh, he's making a joke, right? But you know, you might think that it's probably bad form for the weatherman to say Zeus is angry, right? You know, Zeus is hurling thunderbolts down from Mount Olympus, left and right. You know, as a weatherman, maybe you make a little joke about it, but you want to use that as your language. And you don't want to put that in your weather report if you're a meteorologist. You want to talk about, you know, there's a cold front coming in from the west, and you want to talk about, like, numbers and temperatures and pressure zones and barometric pressure, right? If you start talking about Zeus or Mount Olympus, people think you're crazy. And if you do it, even if you don't really believe it, but if you use that language, you kind of give credence to people that might think, well, maybe God really is angry. Why is the weather so bad here? You know, and you even get, you know, people write books about, you know, Mother Earth creating a bunch of storms because she's upset about the global warming or something like that. I mean, people do believe these things. They talk about the Gaia theory and the Earth is a living being and stuff like that. And the scientists say, no, that's a bunch of nonsense. And even when you deal with the human mind, if you use the language of folk psychology, if you talk about beliefs and intentions, and you should just avoid that, because what you're doing is you're giving credence to Descartes without knowing it. you're giving credence to the superstitious idea that there's a ghostly mini me inside your body that's sort of controlling it, like a pilot in a ship or something like that. Questions or comments about this? It's kind of a fine distinction, right? It's now both the reductive materialist or so they're called eliminative materialists in that they say, get rid of all this talk about the mind. Let's only talk about the brain, or let's talk about behavior. And actually, the eliminative or reductive materialists will have different tacts on this. So one tact is to say it's all behavior. You describe mental phenomena with behavior. Another tact is it's all about the brain. I suppose there might be some people that say use a combination of the two. So it's eliminative and wants to eliminate talk about the mind. And then it's reductive because it reduces everything to brain activity, or it reduces everything to behavior. So you only talk about the behavior, you don't talk about like what intentions motivated the behavior, or what a person was trying to do, or what they're thinking about. You just talk about what they did and what you observed with your senses. So that's one a reductive materialist. They're kind of hardcore materialists that don't even want you to mention the mind, and don't mention anything, don't use any mentalistic language, at least when you're trying to be a philosopher, a scientist, or do something intellectual. Hang out with your friends. It's sort of like, I guess using certain kinds of slang, right? You think about it. It might be appropriate to use a slang or foul language, with your friends when you're just hanging loose. But you don't want to do that with when you're given a conference paper.
This is work jargon.
Yeah. Avoid the because if you use the language of the enemy, you're gonna give the enemy ammunition, and you're gonna spread false ideas. Just the regular materialists, so the simple materialists, come in two versions. One's called logical behaviorism. And actually, I'd say the logical behaviorist is the eliminative or reductive materialist who says it's all based on behavior. So this fellow Gilbert Ryle, and he wrote this big paper against Descartes where he expounds his view of logical behaviorism. In the first part of the paper, he just basically says Descartes's out to lunch. There are no spiritual substances. The mind is a separate substance for the body. It's all physical stuff. But then, what about this mentalistic language? What about Descartes' argument that they're conceptually different, that ideas don't have weight and size and color and shape like material objects do, that they're fundamentally different substances? And he kind of he ridicules Descartes and says, well, Descartes thinks you're a ghost in a machine, that there's this ethereal mini-me inside your body that kind of floats around and follows it around. And then when you die, it sort of floats up to heaven or maybe to a bad place, and says there's no place for that yet for a modern thinking person. And so, but he says the reason that people get confused about this and they lend the view credence is that it's the language people uses. And so it's interesting, Descartes himself actually, this is a good exam question, by the way. Descartes says that the mind-body problem, or his solution to the mind-body problem, doesn't say that it's like a pilot in a ship. So Descartes actually says that mind and body are so commingled that it's easy to confuse them. And it's only when you think as a philosopher that you can see they're actually separate substances. So he would say, if you injure yourself, you don't think, oh, my body has an injury. You think, I've been injured. You think, oh, no, I'm bleeding. You don't say, my body is bleeding. you tend to think about your body as being you. You think, oh, I need to lose some weight, right? You don't say my body needs to lose some body mass. So it's a lot more intimate. And it's only when you think in the abstract, you think, well, what is my mind anyway? And is it the same as my body? If you kind of step back and think about it, and you think, oh, well, no, mind and body have totally different properties. They must be different substances. So my soul actually must be separate from my body. And so Ryle's Ghost in the Machine seems to imply that there are these sort of substances that are totally distinct. And Descartes says they are distinct substances, but they get confused. And because you are an embodied mind, it's an intimate relationship where the two are co-mingled, and you're so mixed with your body that it's hard to tell one from the other unless you sort of detach yourself and think about it in objective terms. So he's what Ryle says is Descartes made what he calls a category mistake. And he gives a few examples of this. And he says it's really hard to describe what a category mistake is. And he tells you, well, it's when you mistake one category of things for another. Well, that's helpful, right? So he says, okay, I'll give you some examples. So he gives the example of the university. So and he says you're at a university and you're being given a tour and you see, okay, well, this is, you know, a lecture hall, and here are the laboratories, and here's the library. And if the person would have asked you, but where is the university? They would have made a category mistake, because they don't understand that the university is the name of the collection of buildings and the faculty and maybe the institution, that it's a quality that applies to the an institution. It's not the name of any particular building. So we might say, you know, you take someone on a tour of Lane, right, and you'd say, okay, here's the center building because it's in the center, and here's the enrollment services. They keep on changing the name. It used to be Students First. And here's the library. If the person said, well, where's Lane, this Lane Community College I heard about? Oh, no, that's the name of, like, all these buildings together. It's the name of the institution. So that's a category mistake. Another example, and maybe more apropos, is suppose you take somebody, a foreign student who's not from Japan, and you take them to, or South America, I guess, and you take them to a baseball game, and you're, you know, sort of explaining the game to them, and, you know, you're like, wake up. the game's still going on, and you say, okay, and the person would say, okay, so that's that guy behind the plate, that's the catcher, and the guy with the big wooden stick, that's the batter, and then, you know, left fielder, right fielder, baseman, pitcher's the guy throws the ball. Where's the team spirit? And you say, is it that guy over there on the side? That's the referee. Well, where's this team spirit I hear about all the time? It seems to come up a lot. And you say, no, it's not the name of a particular player. It's a quality exhibited by the players as a whole. And then maybe you see, like, you know, a team is really behind, and they come up from behind and win. And you say that, and you might tell them, that's the team spirit in action. That's like when you're behind, you pull together and beat the other team by having team spirit. Or maybe like the pitcher beans the batter, and the batter charges the mound and tries to punch out the pitcher, and you say, oh, that's not team spirit. That goes against the team spirit. So that's, again, it's a category mistake, because you're thinking that the team spirit, or your friend is thinking the team spirit's a particular player and not like a quality exhibited by all the players. And what Ryle says, this baseball game example. And what Ryle says is that Descartes making the same kind of mistake. He's mistaking one fundamental category of things for another. And like the university example and like the team spirit example, he's confusing two things. And the things he's confusing is material objects with behavior. He's confusing two things. The sort of say this the right way. He sees language being used in a certain way, and he thinks it looks like it's referring to an objective world and to particular material things and substances. But this language doesn't refer to a particular thing, the mind or the soul. It refers to the way bodies behave or certain the way people act. And so the confusion is thinking that there's such a thing as ideas and feelings and emotions, which are as real as rocks and trees and water and all the physical things. And in reality, mental language just refers to the way people behave or the way they might behave in certain circumstances. So if you say, I have an idea in mind, it doesn't mean that you have a literal mind, which is a separate substance, and that inside that literal mind, there's a literal idea, which is as real as a rock or a tree. And that's the way Descartes thinks about it. He thinks about your mind as an immaterial substance, as real as physical substances, just with different properties. And so you say, I have a mind, I have a body, both exist. They just have different properties, and my mind is an immaterial substance, and my body is a material substance. And Ryle says, no, that's wrong. Your mind isn't a substance at all. The mind is a way of describing the way your body acts and other people's bodies, or how they might act under particular circumstances. Actually, that's a good place to stop, and we'll pass my break. So let's take a 10-minute break, and we'll come back and finish off Gilbert Ryle and get to some other stuff. back to this here. So mentalistic language. So Ryle's idea is that to avoid talk about the mind, you want to talk about behavior, because the mind doesn't exist. There are bodies and their brains. But what does mental language refer to? It refers to behavior. So you look at something like Al is angry. So what does that mean? So you think of, like, when you say Al is angry, what, like, normally what do you think about when a person's angry? What does that mean to you when you say that? Yeah, and that's what, you know, and what Descartes would say about this is that, I don't have that on here. Descartes would say Al has an angry feeling in his mind. So he would say that, you know, Al is, has a feeling in his mind that he's expressed, and he might be expressing it, but the idea is that Al's got something going on in his mind, and then there's behavior that shows that. But what Ryle says is there's no, like, Al's soul is an angry state. Maybe that's a better way of putting what Descartes would say. Al's soul is in an angry state. But that's not what anger is. Anger is behavior. So Al is behaving angrily. He's red in the face. He's yelling, pounding his fists on the desk or whatever. You know, there's a range of things that angry people do. So they would say that, you know, you have to stick to what you observe, right? So can you peer into Al's soul and see what's in his soul? No, right? Al doesn't have a soul. Al is just a body with a brain in it. Can you look at Al's brain and see what's going on in there? Not really. You have to go on the basis of his behavior, because that's public and it's observable. Now, maybe if you scan his brain, you know, you might get something that's maybe some brain state that's associated with that feeling. But it's not what the word anger means is it refers to not some secret state of Al's soul, which doesn't exist, not a secret state of his brain, which is not publicly available to you. When people use the word anger in conversation, it's based on observations of behavior. So the idea is that's what the word anger means. It refers to a set of behaviors, not to a state of a soul, certainly, because no such thing exists. But also, you know, Ryle would say it doesn't refer to his brain either. Because words, you know, that when we use them, they refer to our experience. They don't refer to secret properties of things that are unobservable. And you can't observe people's brains, right? So maybe under special circumstances, you're doing a psychological experiment and you're doing a brain scan on somebody to try to figure out what sets of behaviors might be associated with certain kinds of brain states. That's a special case. But when you're dealing with ordinary language, right, what do words mean? When people use them, anger refers to the way somebody acts. It doesn't refer to a secret state of their soul. And so that's that category of mistake. Descartes thinks that anger is a state of this non-existent soul, which is a separate substance, when really it's a different way of describing how someone's acting. Like the team spirit, right? The team spirit isn't a particular player, it's a quality all the players share. I don't put that on there yet. So what do you think about this as like an analysis of what mental language refers to? Any thoughts about this? Like when you say, you know, somebody's angry, is that what are you talking about, the way they behave? Or what about, like, if somebody's maybe they hide their anger, right? I don't know if you know people like that. Sometimes people don't hide it very well, right? So you might have like, I don't know, like, for example, you might see, you might have a partner that maybe you live with, and She's banging the covers around, making a ruckus, and kind of making a lot of noise. And then you ask her, honey, is something the matter? And she says, no. Right? Are you sure? Nothing's wrong, right? But the tone of voice tells you that, oh, something is wrong. So then you have to do the mind reader thing where you have to, like, you know, try to figure out what's in her soul. But your behavior tells you something's wrong, right? So sometimes people hide it. But what if she is really good at hiding her anger? What if she really was angry, but she didn't show it? Then what would Ryle say about that? You ask her if she's angry, and maybe she says nothing's wrong, and she doesn't say in an angry tone, so nothing in her behavior does it. But could she still be angry? Yeah, it seems like maybe so. So Ryle has this funny thing. He would say, well, that behavior includes verbal behavior. So Ryle says, you know, if you were to ask her if she's angry, she would say yes. But then what if you ask her if she's angry and she says no? What if she's lying to you? And then Ryle says, well, if you were to ask her if she's angry and she were to answer you honestly, she would say yes. And then it seems like he's kind of straining this definition of behavior of basically, you know, telling you something about her secret mental state. And so maybe you're back to this idea of, of ideas and emotions and things referring to a secret mental state. They ask this question, how do you know you're angry? Yeah, do you have to look in a mirror to see if you're angry? You say you can, but would you ever do that? Would you ever say, am I angry? I don't even know how to find a mirror here. Oh, I'm kind of flushed in the face. I think my jaw is clenched a little bit there. I'm gritting my teeth.
Assessing yourself.
Yeah, it's kind of a bizarre idea, right? Because the idea is you know you're angry from the inside out. And the only difference is other people, maybe it's harder to tell. Yeah.
I've had this happen to me when I was younger, when I would be freaking out, and then I would look at myself in the mirror, and it would make me freak out more.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't know.
And there, maybe, sometimes people, I suppose, go into a fugue state, and they just kind of start screaming, and you show them how erratic they're acting, and maybe they calm down a little bit, but the idea is if you're just upset with something, typically you're aware of what's in your own consciousness. So the idea is that anger for you, then the question is anger for you different from somebody else? Does anger mean one thing when I'm angry, and does anger mean something completely different when somebody else is angry? My anger refers to my feelings in my mind. Other people's anger just refers to their behavior. That doesn't seem consistent.
It's how we react to our anger, right?
Like, yeah.
We have a thought, and then our body reacts to this feeling that we're thinking, and then we start, throwing stuff and waving our hands.
Pacing around.
And people behave differently. Like, some people, they get really quiet, and they just, sit there. Some people, they'll give you a bug-eyed stare. You see that there's certain people, I think it's this genetic thing, their face will flush. Like former President Bill Clinton would do that. He had this thing where his glow, you'd see his jaw clench. Sometimes you see that little, bone back there, kind of, it's like it's the muscle kind of popping out there when the person like, but he would turn like beet red. The Prophet Muhammad had this thing, the same thing, where he would get angry, he would get red in the face. Some people scream and yell, and carry on, and other people just keep it in, or they're stony-faced.
Or cry.
Or cry, yeah. Or cry. So then the question is there, could you have a definition of anger if... It seems like it's not completely different. Like, there's a range of behaviors. Like, for example, people don't laugh when they're angry. At least they don't laugh in the same way as people add that laugh when they think something's funny. There's a laugh that's described as like a sardonic or a rueful laugh. Mm-hmm. tell me about it. Right? There's a certain kind of laugh that's kind of derisive, sarcastic laughter. And it's pretty easy to identify even outside of context. It sounds different. So it seems like there's still a range of behaviors, but are those behaviors anger, or are they evidence for anger? So, and I think my view on this is that it seems that they're confusing mental states with what the evidence for those mental states. So the only reason it's different for you is because you know how it feels when you're angry, but you can't telepathically, peer into the other person's mind and see whether they're angry or not. You have to guess. And how do you guess? Well, you guess based on the behavior. And it's sort of like an argument by analogy. Well, I know how I am when I'm angry, and maybe there's some biology here too. Like even, my cats can tell when, somebody's upset. They can tell when they're in trouble. There might be something in human nature that a harsh, low tone or a loud, screechy tone might mean, something's wrong. And then sort of a smooth, soothing tone might mean everything's okay. So but the idea is it's indirect. I can't peer into your mind, and so I have to see what your body's doing. For myself, I can peer into my own mind, but I can't see yours. So the idea is that Ryle is taking behavior and trying to make it into mental states, when really behavior is just evidence for mental states in others. And you get this a lot in philosophy. I think you get people confusing one thing for another when they're closely related. So it's the idea of argument by analogy. I think you're angry, and this makes sense. You can misinterpret behavior, right? So under Ryle's view, you can never misinterpret behavior. So like, for example, when I had like regular TV, I would be in the kitchen during the commercial break, rushing around to trying to make a snack, right? And so I bang the covers around and I kind of make some racket, and then my wife would say, "Is something wrong?" And I'd be like that. I'd say, "No, I'm just in a hurry," right? And she'd say, "Well, you're making a lot of noise in there. It makes me think that something's wrong." So that's a misinterpretation of behavior. Or you might see a person that like never looks at you. So you're like, "Oh, I walked by and so and so like avoids my glance, and I think she's stuck up. She thinks she's better than me," right? And it turns out that maybe she has social anxiety and has a hard time interacting with people, and she doesn't know you, and so she's avoiding you, not because she thinks you're better than you, but because she has a problem with self-esteem, maybe. So it's easy to misconstrue behavior, right? I was just, you had to be really careful about that, too. I remember I was hanging out at the Welcome Week thing, and I was talking about this, I'm trying to remember the exact context, but I was talking about people that have a sort of narrow, dogmatic, ideological view of life, and are, kind of totalitarian. And I just made this gesture like that. And then I was like, I'm still waiting for the elevator. I'm like, "Oh, that's not gonna look good." I was just talking with this guy, Detrick, who's also a person of color running for the Senate also, and signed his petition, and talked to him, and he runs his own business and seems like a real go-getter. And he's a cool guy. And so I could just see, the torch, professor gives not least salute to the person, to senator of color or something like that. The senatorial candidate of color, right? When I'm talking about people with intolerant views and gave the weird, joking around and say, "Oh, this person," and I was thinking of a particular person who's like very ideological and intolerant and just, doing a funny gesture. I'm like, "Oh, somebody could totally misinterpret that." So, That was probably a bad idea. But the person I was talking to knew the one I was talking to and like nodded their head and smiled up. That's how they are. That's how they are. Anyway, so you gotta be careful though about saying the wrong message. Even if you wear a funny hat. So here's Julien Offre de la Mettrie, French philosopher, materialist. And I gave you a little selection of him here in the text. And he is one of the first really early materialists, you know, maybe out of the closet. I suppose Thomas Hobbes is sort of another materialist who's maybe more out there. So he suggests this idea, the mind-brain identity theory. And so maybe logical behaviorism doesn't work. So his idea is just the mind is the brain. So on the test, you're going to see the mind-brain identity says, and the correct answer will be, the mind is the brain. And you're going to see that answer A, and you're like, oh, that's too easy. It's got to be one of these other ones. No, that's the answer. The mind is the brain. The mind is identical with the brain, hence the mind-brain identity theory. So it says that what you think about as being your mind is kind of an illusion. So there's a philosopher named Daniel Dennett who says the mind is the brain's user illusion of itself. So you kind of tend to think about your mind as distinct from your body and even distinct from your brain. And the idea that the mind-brain identity theorists have is that you have this kind of user illusion where you think about yourself as being this thing that is using your brain. But that itself is an illusion created by the brain. So there is no little mini-me inside your brain, a soul or a consciousness. Your brain is conscious, but the way consciousness works, and we're not sure why this happens, that consciousness makes you think about yourself as being a thing inside your head when there is no thing inside your head except for your brain. And your brain is you, essentially, and your consciousness is created by your brain. There's no separate you from your brain. You are your brain, and your brien is you. So Julien Offre de la Mettrie, it should be de la Mettrie, I think. Man and Machine, his groundbreaking book. I think this is a fellow that he got an audience with Napoleon, and Napoleon asked him, sir, I read your book, and I'm wondering what place does God have in your philosophy? And his answer was, sir, I have no need of that hypothesis. So and this is kind of a startling thing at the time. He's writing the late 18th century. The Enlightenment's full going. There's this foppish hat. Mad at that? What's that?
Did Napoleon get mad at that? I
think Napoleon's kind of open-minded. Napoleon believed in God, but he didn't. You know, there was sort of this phase where you get the Enlightenment where people worried about being, you know, persecuted by the church or tortured like Galileo or what have you. And then as things go on, people get more accepting of a more secular approach. But at the time, it was sort of startling and maybe scandalous that, you know, atheists were tolerated, but kind of not, definitely not in the majority. I'll talk about like this first argument actually isn't one of his arguments. And then the next two are going to be more similar. And then maybe, let me see, go forward here a little bit. I wanted this number two is more of his. Let me see if I can, I'll use my arrow keys. Let me leave vitalism aside for a minute. Let's talk about number two. brain injuries cause mind injuries. So, you know, Lemaitre talks about cases where it seems that if you injure the brain, it causes a difference in the way the mind functions. So you hit one part, you get a hit on the head and you can't remember stuff, right? Well, the memories exist in your mind, right? Well, it seems like if every time you injure your brain a certain way, that it causes your mind to function differently, your mind just is your brain. If all your memories existed in an immaterial soul, why would getting a hit on the head make any difference? And he gives the example of people that, you know, take drugs, drink alcohol, it causes differences in consciousness, right? Those are chemical things happening in your body. Why would you have a difference in consciousness if your mind is an immaterial substance, completely different from your brain? So you get hit in the head, you get amnesia, temporary, permanent. If you get hit on one part of your head, you lose your short-term memory, and so you can't form any new memories, and so like the world is always new to you. There's a person that had this happen to him, and basically like he'd be in his hospital bed there, and they'd bring him a magazine to read, and he'd read it, and then a little later he'd be bored, he'd pick up the same magazine and read it again, and it'd be like the first time he'd seen it. And the nurses were always new to him, and everything, like the world is sort of recreated every hour or something. Other places, you can remember new stuff, but you can't remember old stuff. Your long-term memory is gone. Sometimes you get hit in one part of your body, and you can't use language that well, because that's the part of your brain that deals with language use. People have a stroke, they have to learn how to talk again. I remember my grandma had a stroke, and she couldn't think of words, and she'd get one that was close, like she wanted to say pillowcase, and she said envelope, right? And you think about, well, it's white, it's something you put something else in, it's got a little flap that you open in, it's similar, right? So people have to learn how to talk all over again. So all those things, and even morality, there's a famous case of Phineas Gage. Is the guy's name? So what happened? Do you remember what happened to Phineas Gage?
Yeah, he got like a spike through his head right here or something, and like people described him before that happening as being like a calm, collected person, and then afterwards he was more, I guess you could say, he had less inhibitions, he cursed more, he was angry more.
Yeah.
Stuff like that.
So there are certain parts of your brain which deal with emotions, so and with social interaction. So he just had these wild mood swings, laughing, crying, being angry, swearing, saying irrational things. So there are all sorts of, you know, diseases of the brain, or blunt trauma, or a railroad spike through your head. You know, all those things that cause differences in cognition. Well, it makes it just look that all the action is in the brain, because you don't get a railroad spike through your soul. And if you do, it wouldn't have any effect, right? So Lemaitre makes these kinds of arguments in his piece there. Another piece, going back to number one here, vitalism is this idea that there's a vital force which is responsible for life and also for consciousness. But this idea of the vital force is that in addition to the biological picture, there's also a spiritual picture. And this is the idea behind the awesome, gory sci-fi movie Life Force, with an alien that sucks the life force out of people, right? And this is the idea that there's this kind of sort of magical property that people have, the vital force, which is their life, which if taken away, they'll turn into a desiccated corpse from the life vampire. And this was something that made sense when people didn't understand how a biological life worked. But as soon as people uncovered the workings of the cell and they discovered, oh, it's all electrochemical energy, it's all, Well, let me ask, well, what makes a person alive? What is life? I mean, where is this, the life force? What is it really? I suppose if you're not going to be, if you're going to be like a regular materialist, not like a kind of a hard-ass, limited or reductive materialist, what would you say the vital force really is? That's part of what makes your heart go. Electrical impulses. Where do those come from? That's energy, right? They come from the vital force. Well, it's like the. Eventually, it comes down to like the mitochondria in the soul, the cells, right? It's the powerhouse of the cell, and you know what makes that go? How does your mitochondria and how do your cells? How do they produce those electrical impulses, electrochemical energy? Where does that come from? What's that?
Your brain.
Well, actually, your brain.
It's connected to your whole body.
Yeah, but where does your brain get the energy to run?
Like sugar.
Yeah, it's from the food you eat, right? It's like the same reason your car goes, right? You put gas in the car and it burns it. Well, your body burns fuel, and this is what they call calories, right? A kilocalorie is a unit of energy. This is why, like, if you pick up your, you know. You pick up some food that's horribly bad for you, full of sugar, and instead of like calories, it says energy, right? So you, oh, I need energy. Instead of thinking, oh, I need 300 calories, you know, I need energy, so I'll drink this energy drink. Some of that's the caffeine, but the food is energy, and it fuels the electrochemical processes of your body. The vital force, gone by the wayside, in the ash bin of scientific history, only to float up, you know, on Coast to Coast AM with George Norrie, and, you know, Carillion photography, and some guy talking about past life experiences, and, you know, all that kind of stuff. But, you know, scientific journals, I think you'd be hard put to find a reference to the vital force. It basically disappeared, and, you know, occasionally people bring up this experiment that this guy did in the teens, I think 1913, where he weighed people right before and then right after death. And supposedly there was a difference of 23 grams. And there's a movie about it. But basically it's some guy as sort of an amateur, he might have been a physician or a veterinarian or something, but he's doing this as kind of like as like a hobby on the side and not using very accurate scales and, you know, and he wrote it up in a scientific paper and he even says, well, you know, it's kind of half-assed, and he describes his method about everything he did and doesn't really put much stock in his results, but people glom into that and say, oh, the soul weighs 23 grams. Basically, you know, in the 20th century, this idea that the vital force, which used to be accepted by scientists, and now is gone by the wayside. And so what the materialists will say is that the soul is on its way there too. And even though a lot of people believe in souls, a lot of people believe in the vital force, the soul is an hypothesis that you no longer need. Once we understand how the brain creates consciousness, nobody's going to believe in souls anymore. There's going to be something like the mitochondria, something like understanding metabolism and how the body converts food to energy, how it's all electrochemical, how the brain works on electrochemical energy. We'll figure out what consciousness is, and people stop believing in nonsense like souls or spirits. Actually, let me stop there for a minute. What do you think about that? As an argument, this analogy with the vital force, or the brain injuries and mind injuries, either one of those.
So is the argument saying that there is not a vital force? Is that
yeah, so the idea is that...
Julian?
Yeah, no, his is more the brain injuries caused mind injuries. So he gives lots of examples about, you know, somebody drinks an intoxicated drink, He loses capacity for judgment, makes bad decisions. He gives an example of a person that hasn't eaten for a while and is really hungry, and then he's very irritable and angry and kind of says things he regrets later because he's irritated in a different state. So the idea is that our body, our impulses for food, or you know, sleep. He talks about if a person has got enough sleep, they might be irritable. All these things are physiological effects of the body and the mind. And so it's not just even, you know, injuries and disease. Well, he talks about those things too, but also the conditions of the body affect the mind. If your mind is an immaterial substance, it seems like it just sort of be floating there, and you should be perfectly rational all the time. It wouldn't matter whether you hadn't got any sleep or hadn't got anything to eat, or whether you just drank a bottle of vodka. You should be perfectly rational and be able to make objective decisions. And it shouldn't matter. You know, you should be able to remember everything that ever happened to you, even if you get hit on the head by some the J20 activists at the Trump inauguration or whatever, right? So is that the end of it? So you think, well, why is it that every time your brain's injured, cognition is impaired if the mind is an immaterial substance? It makes it look like it's just the brain. You do something to the brain, you get a difference in consciousness. Therefore, the brain creates consciousness, or it is consciousness. The brain is conscious, I guess, is the argument. So there's, I'll just give like one, so a counter argument is, let me just ask this. What would be a counter argument? Can you think about a way to get around this? Like, especially for those of you who might believe in the soul.
The brain is a middleman?
Yeah.
The soul and the body?
Yeah, so how would that work? Like with the brain is the middleman.
It's like a tool that helps the soul communicate with the body and the physical world, I guess. So by injuring the brain, the soul is still intact, but it just can't communicate with yourself. Just like people that have really sophisticated brains but can't control their muscles.
Yeah.
You know, and like I know one guy who, he can't talk much or do much. He has like an electric wheelchair, but he's also like a computer scientist.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So maybe in the same way you can't control your body, people have they might be able to think if they're not like stuck in this injured brain, and maybe when they die, their soul is freed from the body and able to do all the things that it did before when it was in the brain that was okay, and maybe thoughts could happen outside the brain. And Socrates actually talks about this. He talks about the body as the prison house of the soul, and how philosophers are actually practicing for their death. And so life is a practice for death, because someday you'll be freed from this miserable mortal coil that drives you around with the hunger and feeling hot and cold and having to eat and having to sleep and having to do all the stuff besides philosophize that bother you, and these drives and impulses and desire for the sex and desire for money and for ease and comfort. And his idea is that once your soul is free from all that nonsense, then it can, philosophize in a pure way. And he sees the physical body as being sort of a burden. And that's the way the dualists kind of look at it. But you could say when your soul is stuck in your body, that it's limited by the body. Even though maybe you can't access those memories, maybe they're there in your soul. Maybe you can't think properly, but maybe if your mind was freed from your damaged brain, you would be able to think even better than you ever had in your life. Can you think of does that seem to be a good answer to the materialist, or can you think of a rebuttal from the materialist? Like what would Lemaitre say about this? Or any kind of materialist. So, let me add one more thing. And this would be an exam question. So it's the race car driver analogy. It's similar to what you said, the middleman idea, that the that you can think about the body and the brain in particular as being like a race car, and if like you lose one of your wheels or if the engine is damaged, you're not going to win any races. But the driver still can steer and he can still drive really well, but if he's in a damaged vehicle, he's not going to go anywhere. And so in the same way, you might have a soul that's perfectly capable of thinking and feeling, but if it's in a damaged body and in a damaged brain, it's not going to be able to do its thing, and it's going to have problems.
That reminds me of like the Eastern philosophy of having to do with like the ego is like this burden on us that restricts us and keeps us from being just purely existing and one with everything. You know, it's like these limitations that we create ourselves to function, but mm-hmm. it's not really doing anything but just
staying alive.
Yeah,
it's it opens up a whole can of worms there. What is the self? And actually, we're going to get to that in this thing on personal identity, in the next chapter. Yes?
But getting back to the Bibles, and I think maybe it falls into there, but like you said, kind of with the ego, some people end up personifying like the ego and the id and the superego as like the shoulder angels, and it's like,
yeah.
Be like your soul coming out, kind of. Yeah.
Yeah, it's interesting to think about the different parts of your mind too. Descartes thinks about the mind as being like a unity, but maybe there are different aspects to it. What about like the subconscious mind? So we have this idea of the conscious and the subconscious. It's really easy to describe it in terms of brain function. You might say that we know there's like your autonomic nervous system. So, I'd study the brain, we figure out there's a certain part of your brain that just the brain stem, it controls your heartbeat, your respiration, your blink reflex, all those things. And then up a little higher, you get your medulla oblongata, and that deals with, they call that sort of the reptile brain, and it deals with instinct. So your desire for sex, your desire for food, your fear response, your fight or flight or freeze response, all that stuff is down in your medulla. And then you get up higher, you get to like the cerebral cortex, and then you deal with like higher level thinking, rational problem solving, those sorts of things. And so like the subconscious mind has to do with the id, and I read a paper that actually talked about how Freud's, id, ego, and superego can be identified with certain parts of the brain. And so, like, the id is sort of the reptile brain or the instinctual part of the brain that deals with these sort of primitive drives that are based on survival. You have the prefrontal cortex, I think, maybe, that deals with the superego. That's where your sense of morality and your conscience is, if you will. And then there's sort of the ego, which is in the maybe another part of the frontal cortex that deals with the sort of part of you that's you, self-consciousness. And maybe it's Freud's description of these three parts of the mind is really three parts of the brain. That works really well. This idea of a subconscious mind, like, so what happens when what happens to your subconscious mind when you die and your soul sort of detaches from your body? Do you have a subconscious anymore? Does your soul have parts? It seems kind of weird. Your soul doesn't have to sleep anymore. You don't have dreams, I guess, right? You start thinking about what it would be to be a disembodied mind, it starts seeming kind of weird. Would you have sensations? Would you be able to see things? You don't have any eyes anymore. So then when you start thinking about this idea of a immaterial substance detached from the body with no perceptual organs and with no, conscious, subconscious, things we sort of take for granted, it starts looking kind of implausible, maybe.
And maybe it just turns into something that we don't know at all. It's not like a human form it's just like our energy as a life force.
Mm-hmm.
And it just maybe disappears into oblivion. Maybe we go into space and dissipate. Maybe it's just a fog. Maybe it's like, you know,
yeah.
Maybe it's some sort of energy form, not like a body per se with all these thoughts and feelings.
So there's actually, we'll get this later in talking about life after death. Roger Penrose has this idea of the soul as being a form of coherent quantum energy and that exists in the microtubules of the brain. And so that's a kind of way to try to have a scientific theory of the soul, I guess. But then, you know, to describe, the question is, why isn't that affected by the sort of these injuries to the brain or conditions of the body? And another thing to think about when you think about these effects is, well, it seems like a kind of a complicated explanation. So this whole idea of the middleman. So in philosophy, if you can, you should always cut out the middleman. Why? Because the simplest explanation, all other things being equal, is more likely to be true. So it's called Occam's razor. I should put that on the thing here. Occam's razor. Where are we at? Okay. Now Occam's razor says, don't multiply entities beyond necessity. So this is Occam's razor after William of Ockham, medieval philosopher. One of the few great things to come out of the Middle Ages in philosophy. Where, you know, I guess some stuff, Thomas Aquinas has some nice things to say, I suppose. I think Aquinas and Ockham are sort of the height of medieval philosophy. But this is a great sort of modern thing that can be used. And the idea is you want to slice off the excess. And so Ockham, another way of saying it is the all other things being equal, the simplest explanation, is true. And the all other things being equal is an important qualifier. So when you're talking about, you know, what counts as simple and complex, you think about, well, relativity is like kind of complex, but it also explains a lot. So all other things being equal, there are things that Newton's theory can't explain easily that Einstein's theory explains really easily. So then the all other things being equal kicks in. So if there's some stuff that you observe that can't be explained by your existing theory, and this new theory explains it really well, okay, go with the new theory, even if it's a little more complex. But if one theory explains everything you want to explain, and it's simpler than the other theory, go with that one. Go with the simplest theory. So another good example of that is, like, you think about people used to think the sun is the center of the universe. Sorry, the earth is the center of the universe. Yeah, and now we know that the earth is the center of the universe and is completely stationary and all the planets revolve around it, and the sun does as well. No, it's the... So there's the... I'm starting with the new one again. Geocentric. And then you get the heliocentric. Heliocentric view.
Is that like Helios?
Yeah, so here you have the sun. This is the way things actually are. You have the planets going around it. and here's, you know, the Earth, a third rock from the sun. Whereas the geocentric view had the Earth, and then it had, you know, the sun sort of revolving around it. Now, the problem with this is that if you look at, like, the other planets, you had what was known as a retrograde motion. So you'd look at, like, you'd track the planet, planet Mars or Venus over time. You could see it up in the sky with the naked eye. And, you know, you'd use your telescopes and you'd plot a graph. And you'd say, oh, okay, here it is going across the sky. That's weird, right? It should just be, you know, a straight arc because it's going around. But why is it zigging and zagging like that? That's weird. Why would that happen? And you look at this zigzag thing of the planets, it makes sense if you're the Earth here and here's the planet Venus and it's sort of, you know, going around too. And you see, like, with regard to the Earth, they're at different points as they revolve around there. It's gonna sort of, as you watch it in the sky, it's gonna move around a little bit and kind of wobble. So that was finally what, like, did in the geocentric view. But before that, people said, okay, well, what explains this is that there's kind of this thing, we'll call it an epicycle. And the planet's sort of like going around a circle within a circle. So the idea is that the orbit, the planet Venus is going like this around the Earth. Why would it do that? I don't know, but it works with the numbers and our observations. And then we got even better measurements, and it started it started getting really crazy. And at a certain point, people said, okay, that's not going to work. This is way too complicated. The epicycles is, it's consistent with the data, but it's not, it's too complicated. Whereas if we assume that the sun's in the center and all the planets are revolving around it, including the Earth, everything works out perfectly, right? Now, it's maybe, you might argue this is maybe a more complex way of looking at it, in particular, like, that the Earth is, you know, spinning on its axis like a top. That's kind of complicated at 23.5 degrees. And that it's actually, they're not circular orbits, but they're actually elliptical orbits. So it's not a perfect sphere anymore, and that bothered people. But it works out with the numbers, and even though it's more complex in a certain sense, it's the simplest theory that works with all the data. In order to account for the data, you go for the simplest theory that fits the data. So now we come back to the soul. So what's more simple? The brain creates consciousness, or consciousness is an immaterial substance which it independently could function perfectly well, but sometimes when it's in a brain that gets damaged, you're not actually damaging the soul, but you're damaging the brain, and the soul has to work through the brain, so therefore the brain has, you have differences. The soul can't function too well and makes mistakes, or doesn't function as it should. And that sounds, you know, kind of, it's a lot more complicated, right? So why not cut out the middleman and just say brain creates consciousness, unless you have some special reason for believing the soul. And so the idea is, if you can't have some independent reason for the soul, get rid of it, because it's, you know, excess baggage. Cut it loose. All right, we'll talk some more about this, more about the mind-body problem on Tuesday. Get into personal identity, chapter 3.